Back on Locked On Blue Devils here today, JJ Jackson with a very special guest, Grayson Loftis, the quarterback of the future for the Duke Blue Devils, kind enough to join us here on the program. Grayson, I really do appreciate the time. Duke fans are so excited to see you playing there in Durham in the future. Tell me a little bit about the decision to commit and play football at Duke.
You know, first, I just want to say thank you for having me on. And, you know, just Duke is a special place. You know, when people ask me that question, that's what I always lead with, because it truly is a special area. Durham's just a special place filled with special people. The energy in the air with the new staff, Coach Elko and Coach Johns, especially on the offensive side of the ball, it's just a new energy, new, you know, excitement about football that's in the air. And it was hard to turn them down when they came and they offered us on that Saturday. And, you know, it was just hard to turn them down and say no, and to see a future, a program that's been good in the past, that just has such a bright future under this staff.
Was Duke a school that you were hoping to hear from? Like, when Grayson is dreaming about playing college football, was Duke one of those schools?
Yeah, it was. When we first got our interest from the previous staff, Duke quickly kind of became our dream school, just with how beautiful the campus was and just what everything at Duke is about. Duke's a national brand. Everybody from the smallest town in Georgia to the biggest town in California knows exactly who Duke is. So, you know, it's a brand, a national brand that can be built off of. And, you know, so it was kind of one of our dream schools growing up.
We see that every single day on the basketball side of things. And over the past nearly 20 years, Coach Cutcliffe had done that with the football, and Coach Elko is only going to take it to the next level. Tell me about your relationship that you had with Coach Cutcliffe and the previous staff, if any, Grayson.
You know, we had a little bit of a relationship that kind of dwindled off towards the end of his career and everything at Duke. But, you know, I wouldn't say that it was a super strong one, but we had an acquaintance there.
What were you looking for in a school when you were looking for your college destination?
The two biggest things we were looking for was number one, was it a family atmosphere? You know, we wanted a place that valued family, that treated football like the football team as a family. And that's something Coach Elko truly has built. They were honest up front with us about everything that they were hoping to build and that they were expecting from their guys. And everything he said to us up to this point has been true. And that was the number one mark of for us is was it a family? And number two was just the competition. We wanted to come out and especially in those practices and see people competing and getting after it day in and day out. And I think with everybody on staff's background and where they've come from and how they've gotten to Duke, you know, you see that value of competition at every level. And you look at Coach Johns, who's been top 10 in the country in offense everywhere he's been in the last 10 years. So, you know, he's one of those guys who truly values competition and production. And Coach Elko is the same way. I think that Duke football actually put out a graphic talking about 28 NFL guys under Elko at Texas A&M and his past. And, you know, I think that's something we valued in choosing Duke, was just a level of competition that staff values.
Grayson, we've heard you mention we and us when you're talking about the college football recruitment process. I would imagine that you're referring to your family. How big of a decision did you want this to be with your family included?
You know, it was huge. You know, I touched on family being the biggest thing we were looking for, and that's because family plays a huge role in my life as well. I wouldn't be anywhere I'm at today without my two parents and without my sister. So, you know, having such a tight, close-knit, tight family, you know, really, truly gave me the insight on what it took and what I wanted in a school to be able to go in and walk into a family atmosphere. So, yeah, family played a huge role. I wanted my grandma and my grandparents to be able to come watch me play on Saturdays. So, you know, that was a huge, huge deciding factor for me as well.
I know that the story goes it's a Saturday visit up to Durham, and you don't leave before telling the coaching staff that this is where you want to play and that you want to be a Duke Blue Devil. What kind of were those first interactions, though, with Coach Elko and Coach Johns? And honestly, just walk us through that full day, Grayson. Did you go up expecting the day to play out the way it did, or what were you expecting?
So, you know, the part of the people that don't realize is we'd only been talking to the Duke staff for 2 weeks before that day. So, you know, we had plans to go that next weekend, and we were making our decision that next weekend. And so, you know, when we walked up and we got there that Saturday, it all just kind of started off with spending the day with Coach Johns and getting to know him a little bit on a personal level, and then meeting with Coach Elko and having a 35, 40 minute conversation with him, where everything he said was just true and real to us. You know, he didn't try and sugarcoat anything. He didn't try and tell us anything we wanted to hear. He just told us what he told us his spiel and was just honest with us. You know, he wasn't trying to sugarcoat and tell us what we wanted to hear. It was just honest, and everything was real about it. You know, the biggest thing that I noticed too was they weren't just recruiting me, that the school was recruiting my parents as well. They wanted my parents to make sure that they were comfortable with everything that Duke has to offer and that Duke is. So, you know, we weren't expecting it to be what it was and how play out how it did. But we were definitely happy and excited that it definitely played out how it did.
Yeah, well, I mean, what's that car ride back home like then, Grayson? Like, you leave and you've committed all of a sudden.
Yeah, no, I think when we left, you know, we hadn't told the coaches quite yet. I think they had a pretty good idea, but when we got in the car, I told my mom and dad, I said, you know, guys, I think that's the place for us. And that was kind of the conversation we had. And, you know, we actually called them that Sunday night. And that was the official. We called Coach Elko and put him on the phone and we told him what our plans were and that we were going to be his first guide to kind of build this class around. And, you know, we hit the ground running from there, and it was just all excitement on our end.
How cool is that? I mean, Mike Elko takes over. What a big career he's had as a defensive coordinator, and now he gets to be the head man in the ACC, rebranding, rebuilding a football program like Duke, and you're the first high school recruit that commits to Coach Elko. How cool is that?
You know, it was an awesome experience. It was kind of something we had the chance to do, and we wanted to be – that was important to us. We kind of wanted to be that first guy for Coach Elko. Because ultimately he took a chance on us, to be able to be that guy. So, you know, I've always valued loyalty and that aspect of recruiting, because you don't find it a whole lot. So when he gave us that opportunity and gave us the chance to be his first guy, we wanted to jump on that and take that opportunity. So it was a blessing and a fun opportunity. And me and him will always have a special bond because of me being his first guy and him being one really truly the first guy to give me a chance.
You pointed out the draft success that Coach Elko had at Texas A&M, and you want to look at the draft. It's you know, currently happening at the NFL level right now, and we'll see future Blue Devils in the future years get that chance to play at the next level. Daniel Jones, obviously one of the most noteworthy quarterbacks coming to mind, a top 10 player, a top 10 pick that wore Duke across his chest and is now playing at the next level. Did that give you any comfort or confidence knowing that, okay, I can play football in that quarterback position at a school like Duke and make it to the next level?
Yeah, it did. I think, you know, Duke's got a long history of putting guys in the NFL. So, you know, I think having a guy like Daniel Jones who's come to Duke and kind of taken a similar walk and made it, you know, been that number 6 overall pick in his draft class did give us a little bit of comfort. But then again, too, it was we had found the right place for us, and we knew that, you know, God's got a plan and it's going to work out however it works out. And we trusted Coach Elko and Coach Johns that, you know, as long as we do our part and they do their part, everything's going to take care of itself and we'll get to where we're supposed to be at.
Knowing that in your playing career, you're going to get to be a part of the Duke and UNC rivalry, how exciting is that? I mean, that's a nationally known rivalry and you're going to get to be the quarterback in it.
You know, I think it's something I've felt since we committed was just the rivalry already. You know, where I live at is it's almost a little bit Tar Heel country, just because of our geographical location. So I think I felt it a little bit since I've already committed, and it's a blast. I love it. I think, you know, getting a glimpse of it with the Duke North Carolina basketball rivalry. You know, I think it can be that with football. It can be that same high animosity, hatred of a relationship. So, you know, I think, you know, us getting back on top of that rivalry is obviously a goal. But, you know, it's exciting to be a part of.
We've got the victory bell each and every year, and it looks way better in the Duke shade of blue than it does in that Carolina blue, that's for sure. All right, you mentioned that now you're the first commit in this Duke class. Paul Davis is the second at the wide receiver position. Have you guys been able to connect, and what's that kind of been like?
Yeah, Paul's a special guy. You know, I think he's not only a great player, but he's a great kid. You know, he's somebody that I've got the chance to get to know on a few visits, and I got to know his parents a little bit. And I have no doubt that, you know, he's a really, really good dude that joins this class and this group. And being able to play with a guy like him is going to be fun and a special opportunity.
What kind of offense do you feel kind of most comfortable in, and what do you enjoy running the most?
You know, I like the pro style. The just whatever it takes to win. You know, I like what we're, what Coach Johns is doing at Duke. It fits us perfectly with the spread. Going to have to throw the ball to win the game, but not completely abandoning the run. You know, I think it you got to be balanced to win football games. So, you know, just whatever it takes to win the football game is where I fit in.
Grayson, if I say the words Dutch Fork state championship game, what comes to mind for you?
Relief. I think people always ask me, you know, was the feelings what you thought it was? And I always say, no, you know, I always thought it would be a different, you know, kind of emotional feeling, but it was more of a sigh of relief at the end of the game. And that, you know, you did it, you know what I mean? It was a group of guys. We had a tight knit team. Stuff had just fell our way all year. And I had no doubt that game was going to fall our way. But you know, it was a special moment in the time, and there's clips of everybody crying and everybody on their knees just looking up and hugging each other. And you know, I think it describes that moment perfectly when you look up and there's 11,000 people there from Gaffney that have been waiting 9 years to get back to that, to the pinnacle of high school football in the state of South Carolina. And you know, I think it was just a blessing and a special chance to be a part of that.
And to add to that, for folks that might not be aware, Dutch Fork wins 62 straight games. They had won 5 state championships at that 5A level. And your school, Gaffney High, able to pick up the state championship victory. With that in mind, I mean, yes, I would imagine you're super excited about the future to play college football. But the high school career is not done, Grayson. How much pride do you have to go out there and finish your last year with a lot of success, and maybe what kind of goals do you still have in your high school football career?
You know, there's definitely a lot of pride in it. Gaffney is a place known for winning championships. They got 21 state championships in their career. So, you know, I think when you're at a place like this, you know, there's definitely a little bit of an edge and chip on your shoulder, and to just continue the winning and continue to be a part of those groups that win football games and bring trophies back to Gaffney. So yeah, I definitely got a little bit of a chip on my shoulder still of the job's not done at Gaffney High School yet, and Duke's going to be there when this season's over. So we're definitely still focused on taking this 2022 Gaffney football team and win another state championship.
How about that? So high school football will be here before you know it, and then you'll be heading off to Duke. Have you thought about early enrollee, or what's kind of your college football future, do you think, Grayson?
Yeah, so I'm going to mid-year. I'm going to enroll in January and be there for spring ball.
Why do you think that's important, or why did you want to do that?
You know, just a chance to get on campus, kind of get started academically, get an extra semester and start a little earlier for us. And football-wise, just a chance to get in the offense a little bit, learn, you know, be able to come in and get to know the guys on the team. So that way when the season hits, you know, if depending on the situation we're in, you know, I've been a part of the team. I've been a part of the squad for a little while, and have a good grasp of not only college school-wise, but college and football-wise as it turns to that, as it is a big transition to the next level.
Grayson, you had mentioned you kind of want to be able to now help recruit the rest of the class. Again, just 2 commits right now in the class of 2023 for Duke football. What does that look like? Are you actively reaching out to guys? Are you talking with the coaching staff a little bit about that? Or what does that look like for you?
Yeah, so I'm reaching out to anybody and everybody who gets a Duke offer. You know, just talking with Coach Johns and the offensive staff and Coach Elko on who they want, who their top guys are, and you know, just reaching out to them and just letting them get a chance to know me and build that relationship a little bit, and ultimately make Duke football the best that it can be.
What's the one last message you want to leave Duke football fans with, or Duke Blue Devil fans with, Grayson, about the future?
The future is really bright. I think there's a lot of excitement and a lot of confidence in the staff, and it is well earned by the staff. You know, I think with them, you're getting a group of guys who want nothing but for Duke football to be the best that it can be. And they're recruiting guys who are hardworking, guys who love football just as much as they do, who love Duke just as much as they do. So, you know, I think the future's bright, the future is there. But just now time to come out to games in the fall and be excited about it and pack out Wallace Wade Stadium.
Grayson, we certainly do appreciate the time. Thanks for joining me today on Locked On Blue Devils.
I appreciate you for having me anytime.
That's Grayson Loftis, the quarterback of the future, here with us.